sometimes the most unlikely of friends can become the best of heroes.
Ratchet and Clank, the Cosmic Commandos.
And Jack and Daxter, the Masters of Eco.
He's Wiz and I'm Boomstick.
And it's our job to analyze their weapons, armor, and skills to find out who would win a death battle. It was a time of chaos. The unstoppable Kragmite Empire wreaked havoc across the galaxy until a race of unlikely heroes fought back. The Lombaxes. Who may be some sort of lemur wombat?
Well, whatever they are, they're pretty good at kicking the shit out of Kragmites, and ended up stopping the Empire by banishing them to another dimension. Well, all except one, and boy would that come back to bite them in the ass.
Raised as one of their own, the last Kragmite betrayed his foster Lombaxes, raised an army of fish people, and in some sense of cruel ironic justice banished the entire Lombax race to their own dimension as well. And just as ironically missed one who would prove to be his greatest adversary.
This lone Lombax's name was Ratchet, and he spent most of his days stranded on a random planet dicking around with mechanical stuff and dreaming of one day exploring the galaxy. So this alien kitty cat thing scrounged up all the scraps he could find, used his natural gift with machines, and built a spaceship so incredible it would finally take him off this boring planet once and for...
Without an onboard robot ignition system, this hunk of junk would never fly.
And with Ratchet's luck, it's not like one was just gonna drop out of the sky or anything. I'll be damned!
This was the SentryBot serial number XJ0461.
Well, that's hard to say in conversation, and he makes a clanky sound when he falls over, so...
Maybe I'll just call you Clank.
Clank had just been assembled maybe half an hour earlier and was already running for his life.
Yeah, see, he came from a robot killing machine making factory, but when the factory malfunctioned and made this little guy, it decided to scrap him for parts. So naturally, he got the hell out of there, ended up with Ratchet, and together they became the greatest hero duo in the galaxy.
While they started out as an unlikely pair, they've picked up all sorts of experience along the way. Ratchet has been trained as a commando and is proficient in martial arts, heavy weaponry, survival skills, stealth,
ballroom dancing, and origami.
And despite his diminutive size, Clank is an asset in combat as well. When paired with Ratchet, he can act as a personal helicopter or even a jetpack.
Also, turns out Clank wasn't a mistake after all.
He possesses the soul of a Zoni, energy-based creatures with the ability to manipulate time and be immune to time-altering effects. And eventually, these powers manifested in Clank as well.
That's right, he's a robo-time wizard.
Who did you say gave you this thing?
The Zoni. They are little invisible creatures who travel through time.
Oh, right.
Both Ratchet and Clank are loaded with nanotech, microscopic machines which instantly repair their bodies after any injury, though their number is limited.
But Ratchet and Clank's true strength lies up their arsenal. Ratchet's packing your usual Solana-style weaponry, from his trusty Omni-Wrench to rocket launchers. But the real beauty lies in all his wacky weapons, like the Vortex Cannon, which sucks up tiny enemies and blasts them back out like little flaming meteors. The Mini Turret Glove can deploy dozens of auto-targeting machine guns, which can destroy tanks. And of course, there's also a disco ball, which forces foes to helplessly dance before them.
Ratchet's gadgetry also includes energy shields, close-range shredder claws, and a variety of drones to assist him in battle. He's even picked up a gun that turns enemies into tiny, adorable sheep.
But hang on, we can't forget my all-time favorite, the Rhino 5. Part minigun, part rocket launcher, this beauty unleashes a glorious river of death in whatever direction she's facing. All set to Tchaikovsky's 1812 Overture.
I'm honestly surprised you know how to say his name.
Oh yeah, the dude played my favorite musical instrument.
What, the piano?
No. Cannons.
Oh.
Anyway, in their adventures, Ratchet and Clank have done some pretty impressive things. They were skilled enough to win numerous gladiator battles, strong enough to stop the blow of a Wargrok with nothing but an Omni-Wrench, fast enough to dodge close-range laser fire, tough enough to survive an explosive shipwreck, and even the vacuum of space.
However, their ability to survive deadly blows is entirely dependent on their supply of nanotech. If they run out of microbots, the next blow is sure to be fatal. But Ratchet and Clank's greatest strength doesn't come from any outlandish weapon or body-rebuilding nanomachine. Rather, it is their unbreakable bond of friendship and teamwork.
Oh, God, that was so friggin' lame.
Robots are not so easily fooled.
Ah, what's that?
What?
Long before the world bred life, it was filled with Eco. Left behind by godlike beings called the Precursors, Eco came in 6 different types, each possessing a different power. But what became of the Precursors? How did they harness the power of Eco? The answers, they say, lie in the destiny of the mischievous teenage boy named Jack.
Jack was born into royalty as the son of King Dumbass.
Damus.
Dumbass, ruler of Haven City. But Jack lost his future as heir to the throne when some douche named Baron Praxis overthrew his dad. The former king was separated from his son and banished to the wastelands, leaving Jack to grow up a wandering orphan.
Until he was taken in and raised by Samos, the elder of Sandover Village. Here, he met his best friend-to-be, Daxter.
Though I don't know why he would ever want to be friends with a guy that never shuts up.
The sage yaps on about the precursors that built this place all the time. Where did they go? Why did they build this crud?
Before long, Jack and Daxter became inseparable and did just about all their teenage tomfoolery together. Like stealing a speedboat to explore the Forbidden Misty Island.
Yeah, turns out it was forbidden for a pretty damn good reason.
Help! Man, that stung!
Oh no, he fell into the weasel pool!
Well, technically, he fell into a pool of dark eco, which transformed him into an otzel. Whatever the hell that's supposed to be.
Daxter took it pretty well, all things considered.
I'm fine.
By the way, where's the unweasel pool?
It's not so simple. In order to reverse Daxter's transformation, they would have to find the Sage of Dark Eco. To prepare them for this journey, Samos trained them to harness the power of Eco and, in turn, to become formidable warriors.
With green Eco, Jack can restore lost health and create shields. With yellow Eco, he can launch energy projectiles from his hands. Blue Eco doubles his speed and reflexes, and red Eco does the same for his strength, allowing him to take down tough enemies with a single strike.
But when their tinkering with ancient precursor technology sent them tumbling into a dystopian future, it's a long story. Jack was captured and experimented on by Baron Praxis, who wanted to turn him into a super soldier.
Too bad he didn't really know what he was doing, and poor Jack was stuck as his lab rat for 2 straight years, until Daxter finally busted him out. Jack was so happy, he spoke his first words ever.
I'm gonna kill Praxis!
Oh, my first words were beer! Now!
Unbeknownst to Praxis, while his experiments failed to turn Jack into Captain America, they did grant him the ability to consume Dark Eco and temporarily transform into the mighty Dark Jack.
Dark Jack can use Dark Eco for a bunch of powerful projectiles, and he can even triple in size and strength. On top of that, Dark Jack is also completely invulnerable.
That's right, we bad.
You haven't forgotten what I taught you, Jack.
If one super form wasn't enough, Jack gained another when he came face to face with the precursors themselves. And turns out they're all otzels like Daxter.
Oh my god.
They gave him the ability to consume light eco in order to counterbalance the darkness within.
Never guess what they called it. Give up, it's Light Jack.
In this form, Jack can glide through the air, create a force field, regenerate from wounds, and even freeze time itself.
When there's not enough dark or light eco on hand to run around blasting people with godlike energy, Jack wields one of the most versatile weapons ever created, the Morph Gun. Powered by different types of eco, it can work like a shotgun, grenade launcher, or minigun. It can fire ricocheting laser shots, homing needles, and even freaking lightning!
And when Jack sets the Morph Gun to Mass Inverter mode, it can blast a wave of dark eco so absurd it alters the very laws of gravity on anybody within its reach.
Yeah, but if that fails, they can just blast him with a supernova. It basically one-shots about anything.
This place has too much excitement. We need to move back to the country.
Armed to the teeth with weapons and eco, Jack and Daxter successfully dethroned Praxis and saved Haven City thanks to several impressive feats along the way.
Like getting up no problem after being crushed in a cave-in, or tearing through solid metal doors like wet paper. Daxter helps when he can, usually by steering missiles into people, but most of the heavy lifting is done by Jack.
Like the one time he did this.
Jack and Daxter are incredibly resourceful. They won a gladiator-style battle with nothing but an unmodified morph gun.
And their drive to win is so strong they even took first in the Crash City Grand Championship while poisoned.
Even giant terraforming robots trying to destroy the world fall to their teamwork, provided they have enough ego.
They can only carry so much eco at once, roughly under a minute's worth in combat for each color type, and so they rely on replenishing their power by pulling eco from the environment. Also, Jack can be a bit reckless and doesn't always think things through.
Even still, don't underestimate the duo of Jack and Daxter. It's the last thing a lot of bad guys ever did.
Alright, the combatants are set. Let's end this debate once and for all.
It's time for a death battle!
The last time I let Quark fix the warp system.
Actually, weren't you the one who overclocked the accelerator?
Huh. This is new.
Hey! Do you have any idea what you've done?
Yeah, hey guys. Welcome to our home. Make yourself comfortable on the couch. If you can find what's left of it.
Nah, this isn't so bad. I can fix that.
I'm very sorry for your loss, Mr. Weasel.
Weasel? Well, well, well. Looks like it's us who needs to fix you!
Fire! Bring it!
Take that! And one more for your mama! Get up, Jack!
What the fuck? Get a load of this!
Wow, hey, fuck you! Hey, Fuzzball! You're pissing me off! I got him! Mercy?
No.
You're done for!
Watch out! You can't keep up! Rest in pieces.
Whoa!
Ratchet!
Can't you go any faster?
I wasn't designed for this.
Let's try this!
Any more weapons you want to throw at me?
Like I need any more. Well, maybe just one more.
Ratchet, behind us!
Now what?
Get up, Jack!
Curtain.
KO!
Oh, not the weasel guy!
Jack and Daxter were formidable fighters, especially when they had enough eco on hand. But Ratchet and Clank's better teamwork, superior defenses, and overwhelming arsenal trumped them in the end.
Well, they both had ways to patch themselves up. Ratchet's nanotech was way more reliable and plentiful than Jack's green eco.
And Ratchet's shields and incapacitative weaponry were more than enough to put a stop to Jack's more offensive eco.
Haha, take that, nature!
While Jack and Daxter's morph gun was one of the most versatile weapons we've ever seen, it absolutely pales in comparison to the sheer size and power of Ratchet and Clank's arsenal.
Jack's best shot was his dark form. But like everything Jack and Daxter had, it didn't take long to run out of juice. Well, Ratchet and Clank had more than enough gadgets and weaponry to keep up the fight.
Plus, Clank is an infinitely more capable sidekick than Daxter, especially his time manipulation and immunity powers.
It was game overture for Jack and Daxter.
The winners are Ratchet and Clank.
Next time on Death Battle.